Good morning. Grace and peace to you from our Lord Jesus Christ. It is good to have you join us virtually for worship this morning as we celebrate our oneness together in Jesus Christ. During this morning's service, we will celebrate All Saints' Day celebrations with the naming of people who have gone on to be in the kingdom in this past year, a time of remembrance. We will also share the Lord's Supper, and so take an opportunity to gather together some bread, some juice, that at that time you can share together with all of us. Now let's turn our hearts and our minds to the worship of Almighty God. Just another reminder that we are in fact using an old service sermon this morning, but as we have been making our practice, we will post later tomorrow the service from in person in Monongahela and send out a link. God's peace and blessings. Let's join together in our call to worship. How shall we praise our God? With all that we have and all that we are. Praise be to God who has blessed us in such mighty ways. Praise be to God who continually blesses our lives and calls to each of us to be a blessing for others. Hear now our call to confession. Christ calls us to share the heavenly banquet of his love with all the saints in earth and heaven. Throughout Scripture's story and people, God is bluntly honest with us about hopes, dreams, expectations. If we are to be as honest, we must stand before our Lord confessing what we have done and said, as well as our silences and inactions, so that we might experience God's healing tears of forgiveness. Join together with me in our prayer of confession. How often, O Lord, we have believed that the greatest commandment is our love for ourselves solely. We have not heard the cries of those in need. We have turned our backs on opportunities to serve you by serving others. Many times we have thought only of our own wants and desires and ignored the needs of others. Help us to truly understand the commandments to love you with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Let us care for our neighbors both far and near. Bring us back to your loving light, for we ask these things in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ. Hear these words of our assurance. In the midst of our darkness and ignorance, the bright light of God's love shines through, healing our anguished souls. Rejoice, beloved of God, for God's love and forgiveness are given to you this day. For in Jesus Christ we are forgiven. Amen.
There's a peace I've come to know. Though my heart and flesh may fail, there's an anchor for my soul. I can say it is well. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is overwhelmed. The victory is won. He is risen from the dead, and I will rise when He calls my name. No more sorrow, no more pain. I will rise on eagle's wings before my God. Fall on my knees and rise. I will rise. There's a day that's drawing near, when this darkness breaks to light and the shadows disappear, and my faith shall be my eyes. Jesus has overcome, and the grave is
Let's come to our Lord in a time of prayer. Holy God, we come to you before you, lifting to you our joys and our concerns, the hopes and the dreams of our lives. May we be open to your voice as you speak to us. May we see with new eyes and hear with new ears the directions that you have for us and the direction you would have us go. Bless, we pray, this gathering online of people, that they may continue to grow and flourish in love and in grace for the purposes that you have called each one of them. Hear our prayer for those whose lives have touched us, those who are in pain, those who are ill, those who grieve. May we touch their lives not only through our prayers, but through our lives and our actions as well. Lord, we pray that you would be with particular places in our world in unrest. We lift up the nation of Haiti, the situation that unfolded with the missionaries there. For the nation of Ethiopia, where we have mission partnerships, but just for the unrest that is existing in that nation right now. We pray, Lord, for them. We lift up and we ask that you would be with those who are struggling with COVID this day. We pray, Lord, thanking you for medical advances and for the continued distribution of vaccines for those who desperately need it in far-off places. Guide us, bless us, uplift us and hold us, for we are your children, called to your purposes in the world. Hear our prayers, those spoken and those things that are hidden in our hearts. We pray these things in the name of Jesus the Christ, who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
As ministers of Word and Sacrament, there are many ways that we approach what to preach. Mm-hmm. Sometimes the sermons are thematic or seasonally based. Other times we use a cycle called the lectionary that over 3 years covers a broad variety and section of Scripture in an overview. Today we begin another method called the narrative lectionary, which gives us a way to see the story, Scripture, as our story, as a whole. We begin this week with Genesis. Now, if you're anything like us, we spend a lot of time in this life asking, what on earth is wrong with us or with this world? That's even pre-pandemic. Frankly, it happens every time you read the newspaper, watch a 24-hour news show, or peruse the latest web attention grabber. We must acknowledge that there's something wrong, something very wrong with us. This mess of a human race has become not just of itself, but also of nearly everything else, eventually leads some people to ask, where did all that evil come from? Our passage, our origin story, tells us that God is good and created his creation good. So where does the evil begin? Not from God, but from his creatures. And there, our choices to turn away from God's way. In our passage, we meet the Creator and three creatures. You know them all. One of them's character is eternal and uncreated, God, the maker of heaven and earth. Since the Bible vigorously and repeatedly insists that God cannot be the source of evil, it must originate when one of the creatures choose to reject the presence of God. Genesis 3 introduces us to a second creature and calls it the serpent, a part of God's creation. So the serpent was originally good and originally fulfilling God's good purpose. Yet while Scripture doesn't explain how or even who or what turned the serpent, Genesis 3 implies that it surrendered its goodness. It chose opposition to God, to turn away. And then the serpent invites Adam and Eve to join in surrendering their goodness, their proper place and functioning in God's creation. But let's step back for a moment. Think about it. Eden was not an ivory house or a palace overlaid with gold. It was infinitely better, a garden furnished and adorned by God, not by human art. It's God's creation, seen then as beyond, well beyond, any humanly created wonders of the earth. Heaven above was the roof of the house, and never was a roof so richly and curiously painted. And the earth was the floor, and never was any floor so beautifully inlaid. The shadow of the trees were their place of rest. Under them were their dining room and their bedroom. And never were any rooms so finely hung as these. Solomon in all his glory had not had something arrayed like them. Adam and Eve were in the midst of the perfected Garden of Eden. And they had everything they could possibly want or need. There is water for drinking, ample food for eating. There's warmth and beauty and apparent communion with and between man and woman, the garden and God. While life in the garden is wonderful, it is not absolute freedom. Adam and Eve are supposed to care for the garden, and if they do, it will sustain them. But from the start, there are limits. And it is important to note because many people forget the limitations that were built into life in the Garden of Eden. These limits were not imposed upon Adam and Eve for something they did or did not do. Limits were not imposed upon them in that way, just as there were limits once they were expelled from the Garden of Eden. These limits ahead of time existed as an aspect of life within the perfect garden.
And really, God tried to tilt things so that Adam and Eve would make the ultimate right choice. They were given nearly universal permission to eat of every tree in the garden. Even the other tree mentioned in the passage, the tree of life, was not placed out of bounds until sin broke the peace and they were exiled from the garden so they couldn't or wouldn't eat of that tree. everything was permitted except one thing. That tree, the one in the middle of the garden, the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. In a world full of generous permission, there was one simple prohibition. God even told them the dire consequences of violating that prohibition. How hard could it be to obey? They're living in paradise. Again, how hard could it be? Well, very hard. Or to put it in the reverse, disobedience was revealed to be very easy. All it took was a couple of clever lies and some no-brainer decisions. At least that's how it looks from a distance. And maybe that's the point, to show people living at a distance from this disaster how their world could have become such a disaster. Sin is always turning away from God, not knowing God or God's word, seeking to make your own rules, and is clearly being cleverly disguised. It's always a foolish and deadly choice. The serpent beguiled Adam and Eve. It said the only reason God didn't want them to eat the fruit of the tree was because if they did, they would become just like God, knowing everything, both good and evil. And so Adam and Eve stepped outside the circle of obedience and tried to judge God and his command from a position as if they were equals. And it's ancient human folly to think that we can understand God better from our freely assumed standpoint and from our notion of God, that we can, if we would, subject ourselves to God's word. The issue at the heart of the brief conversation between the serpent and Eve is, whose word are you going to believe? The word of another creature or the word of the creator of heaven and earth? Now, when you put it that way, it's a no-brainer, but of course that's not how the serpent put it. The tempter is much more devious. It's very subtly challenged the word of the creator. Did God really say you must not eat from any tree in the garden? God has said the exact opposite, of course, but to ask the question was to sow the seed of doubt. The serpent recognizes their vulnerability, so it contradicts God's word directly. You will not surely die. In other words, God is lying to you. His word isn't true, so you don't need to obey it or fear the consequences. And then the serpent attacks God himself, God's character, God's trustworthiness, by challenging God's motive in giving the one prohibition of their lives. For God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. And there you have it, the heart of the rebellion, the root of evil, the reason Adam and Eve and all of us choose to disobey, because we are all in this. That's why we all need to hear this story again and again. And then the serpent left them alone to make up their minds. Now, we would like to think that they deliberated and thought through it and wrestled with what to do in a struggle. Genesis doesn't tell us, but we actually feel like it didn't take so long. And in the first recorded act of human rebellion, they decided they knew best what was best for them. They exercised their freedom by disobeying God's command.
They ate. And they were immediately ashamed of what they'd done. God confronted them with their disobedience, and immediately the excuses began. They didn't die on the spot, but it was the end of life as they had known it. They had acquired the knowledge of good and evil as a result of the choice they had made. And for that choice, God set them on the curb outside the garden, with their newly needed suitcases lying beside them on the ground, probably full of fig leaves. Adam and Eve's story is our story, of course, not just theirs. It's our story. For we are not content with the limits established for us by God either, are we? We engage with formal corporate prayers of confession each week in worship, because we tend towards pretending that we have nothing to confess. We act as if we are self-sufficient, as if we are not in need of what anyone can give us, as if our every action is justified simply because. pretending we are not at the same as Adam and Eve, that we don't make the same choices of rebellion or make excuses, doesn't make the sin go away. Preacher Barbara Brown Taylor writes, "It will simply leave us speechless before its effect and increase our denial of its presence in our lives." She continues, "The church exists as a community through which God may save us from meaninglessness by reminding us of who we are and what we are for. The church exists so that we may have community into which to confess that we have turned away from the life Christ died to give us, as well as a community that will support us in reclaiming that life. The church exists so we may have a place where we can repent of our fears, our hardness of heart, our isolation, and loss of vision, and where, having repented, we may be restored to fullness of life." This story reveals the choice at the heart of human life. Will you believe the word of the serpent or the word of God? Whom will you trust? Whom will you obey? The choice to believe the serpent's words was easy, because the fruit on the tree was good for food, pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining knowledge. Sin is attractive, and obedience is hard. That's the gospel truth in this text. But obedience is the key to life, while sin is the first step towards death. And that's the gospel truth too. Oh, it looks as though the serpent was telling the truth, because Adam and Eve did not fall dead when they took the first bite of sin. You will surely die. You will not surely die, but you will become like God, is what the serpent said. But they did die. They died to themselves, to each other, to God, and to their environment. Before sin, they were not self-conscious. They were naked, and they did not know it. They were not embarrassed about their God-given identity. Sin killed the innocence of self. It began the great cover-up that makes us mysteries even to ourselves. And they covered up in the presence of each other. That soon resulted in accusations and blame. The communion and the connectedness God intended for them was shattered by sin, and the human community began to die. Indeed, physical death will shatter the very next generation of that family before too long because of competition and jealousy. And they covered up in the presence of God. God still walked in their world, but they hid because they were now afraid. Unbroken, unmediated communion with God was dead, though God would give his life to restore it one day.
And humanity's peaceful relationship with the beauty of creation died that day, as pain and toil, thorns and thistles entered human experience. At the end of this sad chapter, they were excluded from a perfect world in which they had been destined to live forever. As the chapter ends, they are dead people walking away from their home and into a grave new world. You will surely die, and they surely did. When sin entered the world, so did death in all its forms. And this is key. They did not suddenly become like God. They didn't become like God because they were already like God, because God had already created them and us in his image. And it turned out they couldn't accept the limits of being mere image bearers. They wanted to know everything as God did. But that wasn't possible, isn't possible. Oh, they already knew good because they knew God, and so do we, but they didn't know evil. And then they did know. And oh, how they knew. Not just intellectually, but experientially, intimately. Now they knew good and evil, but not as God does, from above, from outside, with complete purity. In addition, they didn't know everything God knew. How could they, being finite? What the serpent offered them was impossible, a fool's errand. Rather than expanding their life, it killed them in all ways. Ever since, humans apart from the grace of God have been like the living dead, dead in sin, as Paul puts it in Ephesians 2, walking with a stumbling, shambling gait like zombies in the movie. We find it excruciatingly difficult to live on God's terms in God's creation. We regularly have no interest in the boundaries God sets for us. Because we prefer to set our own boundaries and make our own rules, we come to think of God as not knowing what's best for us, but trying to wreck all of our fun. We trade trust for disobedience. Our only way out of this mess, is obedience to God's plan. Otherwise, we mess it up every single time. We're reckless. We are, as the hymn writer put it, we are prone to wander without God's help. So where does that leave us this morning? Humankind wasted no time before making excuses for our behavior. According to the biblical account, among the very first words spoken by a man or a woman were words of excuse. God asked Adam, "Have you eaten from the tree of which I've commanded you not to eat?" And Adam responded, "The woman whom you gave to me to be with me, she gave me the fruit of the tree, and I ate." God then turned to Eve, "What is it you've done?" And Eve replied, "The serpent tricked me, and I ate." At the beginning of the sermon, we ask, what is wrong with us? Where does evil come from? And Scripture tells us it's choice after choice after choice that leads us away from God. And the only way out of this hellish chaos is relying on God's plan and God's redemption and God's path to lead us back towards our true home. We're going to make a clear statement here. God doesn't want our excuses. As Christians, we don't need to offer self-justifying excuses. In fact, we can't justify ourselves. That's God's job. After all, we are, in Paul's wonderful phrase, justified by grace through faith. There's another way to put it. We are free to recognize that we are not perfect people. What God wants, what God hopes, is that in a world of choice, free will, temptation, we choose to turn not away but towards the one who made us. And we can do that when we rely on the perfect love of God and God's word. And to God be the glory. Amen. Amen.
This is our celebration for All Saints Day. Let's join together in our liturgy. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. Let us pray together. Lord God, by your grace, we are running a race. We are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses. Patriarchs and matriarchs, prophets and psalmists, disciples and evangelists, martyrs and saints, we thank you for their example. We praise you for their lives of faith. For all your saints, O Lord, who strove to you to live, who followed, obeyed, adored you, our grateful hymn we sing. Lord, by your grace, we are running a race. We are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses, loved ones now resting in you, who guided us, nurtured, and cared for us, ancestors who worked and traveled, lived and died that we might be who we are, where we are, your precious children in this community of believers. We thank you for their example. We praise you for their lives of faith. For all your saints, O Lord, who strove in to die, who counted you their great reward, accept our thankful cry. Lord God, by your grace, we are running a race. We are surrounded by a cloud of witnesses, family members and members of this congregation, fellow believers in every country, every denomination, friends who help, guide, and uplift us, children of your family, sheep of your fold, saints of your redeeming. We thank you for their example. We praise you for their lives of faith. For this, your name we bless, and humbly pray anew that we, like them in holiness, may live and die in you. Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely. And let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us. Looking to Christ, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, on this day we lift up to you, O God, by names, those we have lost in this past year from our lives, knowing that they are with you, with your heart forever. May they rest safely with you. Agnes Chakotay, Richard Charlton, Cheryl Tomlinson, Charlotte Dickey, Antoinette Zeck, John Ferner, Garnet E. Myers Waich, Mumbai George, James Bierbauer, Doug Higginbotham, Marlene Farai Kambungo, Peggy Simon Silly, Ida Westwood Mancinelli, Robert Hillberry, Stacy Mayer, Sally Swenson, Leonard Staley, Kankara Mate. At this moment, we invite you to lift up aloud the names of other individuals not yet mentioned. We celebrate the lives of those we have named, O God, and lift up many more names in our hearts. As part of the family of God, we remember you and we honor you. We know you are with us in the spirit of worship, and you will not be forgotten. We give thanks, O God, for all who have gone on to join with you beyond this life. We trust in the hope of resurrection and the promise of new life in Christ, and know that in our grief and celebration, O God, you are with us through it all, and we are not left alone. In Christ's name, amen. Let's proclaim what we believe. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. This is the feast of the people of God. People will come from east and south, north and west, and gather together at the table in the kingdom. Let's join in our great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. And also with you. Lift up your hearts. We lift them to the Lord. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right to give our thanks and praise. It is indeed right to give our thanks and praise to you, the God of Abraham and Sarah, Miriam and Moses, Joshua, Deborah, Ruth, David, priests and prophets, Mary, Joseph, Peter, Paul, apostles and martyrs, and ordinary unknown saints. You are the God of our mothers and fathers, and our children to all generations. You, everlasting one, made us all. You fashioned us into one people and continue to love us even when we denied our godly heritage. We praise you, joining our voices with all the people of faith of every time and place who forever sing to the glory of your name. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And so, in remembrance of our Lord Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves with thanksgiving as a living sacrifice. In union with Christ's offering for us, we live out the mystery of the faith we proclaim. Christ has died, Christ has risen, Christ will come again. Spirit of the living God, make us one as we partake of these your gifts to you, so that we might be in communion with you and with one another. As we break bread together, may our eyes be opened to see your glory. As we lift the cup of salvation, may we be strengthened to follow your way. Until Christ comes in final victory and we feast together with all the saints at God's great family reunion, keep your church one in service to the world here and now. Send forth comfort as only you can give. Work with who we are, where we are, to form these clay pots into vessels of living praise, that our lives may participate in the same unending song of the universe raised by all the saints. Through Christ, with Christ, in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor and praise are yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Amen. Let us pray together. Lord God, as we gather together, virtually, as we take the elements that we have available to us, we ask that you would bless them. We pray that you would take them and separate them from their common purposes to this extraordinary purpose right now. As we remember your gift given to your disciples so many years ago in that upper room, your gift given to us today in the celebration of this foretaste of the feast that awaits us in the kingdom. Draw us near to you. By your Holy Spirit, lift us that we might commune in your very presence right now. And bless now the elements that we share. Amen. The Apostle Paul shares in Scripture that on the night in which Christ was betrayed, he took bread. He broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, broken for you. This do in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after the meal, he took the cup, and he said, "This is the new covenant that I pour out in my blood for the remission of sins. Drink all of it." Sisters and brothers in the faith, as often as we eat this bread, share this cup, we proclaim his saving death until he comes again. And so now we invite you to share the body of Christ, the bread of heaven. And the cup of Christ, the cup of salvation. Let us pray. Merciful God, strengthen us now with these foretastes of the feast that awaits us in the kingdom. Sustain us by your power and by your Spirit. Convict us and compel us as your disciples. We ask these things humbly and in the name of the one who loves us, Jesus Christ. Amen. Hear our responsive benediction. We have waited patiently for God, and He has heard our cry. He has set our feet on solid ground and kept us steady as we journey together. The Lord will keep your going out and your coming in from this time on and forevermore. Alleluia. Amen.